What if the firm is perfectly competitive in the output market, such that it is one of a very large number of producers who all sell the identical product, but it is a monopsony in the resource market, i.e., the sole buyer of the resource? If you are the monopsonistic hirer of, for example, labor, then you're the only employer in this market. This could occur if there is just a single employer in a small isolated town. You are no longer a competitive hirer of labor, subject to the price determined by the overall supply of and demand for labor in the market. That is, you are no longer a price taker when it comes to the wage that you pay the workers. You are no longer facing the perfectly elastic supply of labor seen in the competitive resource market. No, as the only buyer of labor, that is, the only employer, anyone who wants to work will work for you. The firm sees the entire supply of labor available in this market. What does it mean that the supply of labor is now upward sloping rather than horizontal? Before, in the competitive labor market, wage was constant, and the employer could hire as many workers as he or she wanted at the going wage. Now, each time the employer wants to attract more workers, that employer will need to offer a better price, i.e., a higher wage. Let's look at an example. Let's say that you are the employer. If you pay nothing, no one's willing to work for you, so suppose that you offer to pay $2 an hour. At a wage of $2, only one person is willing to work for you. How do you attract more employees? Offer a better wage. When you offer $4 an hour, two people are willing to work for you. At a salary of $6 an hour, three people are willing to work for you, and so on. The upward sloping supply shows that, at higher wages, more labor will be supplied. There is the concept of a backward bending supply of labor, but I'm not going to get into that in this episode. Okay, so where was I? We wanted to know if a firm is competitive in the output market and has monopsony power in the labor market, how many workers will that firm hire and at what wage? Before I get into that, let me do a quick recap of the firm that is perfectly competitive in both input and output so that we can make some comparisons later. If you remember, we started out with just the workers and the output. From there, because we know that marginal product is the change in output when the resource, labor in this case, changes, we can look at the change in output in the table each time we hire another worker. Once we knew marginal product, we were able to establish the market value of that marginal product by taking the marginal product times the price. If the market determined price of the output is constant, this is a competitive product market, remember, at, say, $2, then we can easily calculate value of the marginal product by taking price of the output times the marginal product. And because the output market is competitive, remember also that the output price is equal to the marginal revenue. This means, of course, that price times marginal product is the same as marginal revenue times marginal product, or value of the marginal product and marginal revenue product are the same. So we can enter the value of marginal product figures into the marginal revenue product column. In the perfectly competitive output and factor market scenario, we also found that the wage is constant, determined by labor market forces, let's say at $8. A constant wage also meant the added cost of bringing in another worker, the marginal factor cost, would be constant at that wage, since each worker is hired in at that same wage. So in the end, with perfect competition in both the output and factor markets, the profit maximizing rule, marginal revenue product equals marginal factor cost, is satisfied at four workers who each get paid a wage of $8. But we aren't dealing with perfect competition in both the factor and output markets, are we? When I started this episode, I said that we want to think about a perfectly competitive output market, but a monopsony resource market. That means we'll have to back up a bit. If we go back to the original data, the labor, total product, and marginal product will be unchanged by the shift in market structures. The product figures were unrelated to the structure of the market. And because we were looking at perfectly competitive output previously, and we're still looking at perfectly competitive output now, the output price, constant at $2 in this case, value of the marginal product, and marginal revenue product are the same as they were before. The difference comes in when we change from a perfectly competitive factor market to a monopsonistic factor market. We change from having a small firm facing a perfectly elastic supply of labor, and therefore a constant wage, to having a single large firm facing the entire industry supply of labor, where wage will rise as the firm tries to attract more labor. In the data table, this means that rather than having a wage that's constant at $8, the wage now rises the more labor is hired. Remember, to get more employees to work for you, you'll need to offer a higher wage. Because the wage rises as more labor is hired, the total cost of hiring the labor, wage W times L, the number of workers, rises much more quickly than in a competitive market where the wage was constant. This, in turn, alters marginal factor cost, defined as the change in cost over the change in the resource labor, substantially. The marginal factor cost values end up being higher than the wages. Why is this? Well, in this model, the firm must pay all of its employees the same wage. Why does this matter? Well, think about it. The employer cannot simply lure in a new employee with a higher wage. All of the other employees' wages must be raised to match. Take the data in our table, for example. The firm can hire a single employee at a wage rate of $2 for a total cost of $2. If the firm wants to attract more workers, it will need to offer better wages. The firm can hire two workers by offering a wage of $4, but because it must pay both employees the $4 wage, the total cost is now $8. So the added cost of the second worker, or the marginal factor cost, is $6. The $4 added salary to the new worker plus a $2 raise for the existing employee. To get three workers, the firm will have to offer a wage of $6, raising the total cost of labor to $18. The third worker, therefore, added $10 to the cost. As each new worker is added, you can see that the marginal factor cost of that worker is greater than the wage paid. The added cost is not only the new employee's salary, but also the raises that must be given to all of the existing employees. Ultimately, the profit-maximizing hiring decision for the monopolist occurs where marginal revenue product equals marginal factor cost, somewhere between three and four workers. To recap, because of the perfectly competitive output market, value of the marginal product and marginal revenue product are the same. Because of monopsony in the factor market, there's a single buyer of the resources, the firm faces the industry supply of labor, and marginal factor cost will lie above the supply. Choosing to hire where marginal revenue product equals marginal factor cost, L-star workers will be hired less than with perfect competition, and the employer will drop down to the supply curve of labor to see what wage the sellers of labor, that is the employees, are willing to accept. Because W-star is less than the market value of the output added by this last worker hired, there is monopsonistic exploitation of labor. In the end, the monopsonistic employer hires fewer workers and at a lower wage than a perfectly competitive hirer. Next time, monopsony factor market, monopoly output market.